Hello.
Hi everyone. Welcome to week nine of Hot Pot Talk season two. I'm David Ng here with my dear friend and longtime creative partner, Jen Sunshine. And we are the co-artistic directors of Love Intersections, and we're also members of Value Co-op. Before we begin, we want to acknowledge that Jen and I are beaming this episode of Hot Pot Talks from the unceded and ancestral territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh First Nations. Part of our work as labor activists and queer artists on unceded territories means working in solidarity with Indigenous struggles for sovereignty, decolonization, reparations, and land back. Over the past few weeks, there have been more and more uncoverings of mass graves at former residential schools, and there has been a call to support MPs Mumulak Kakak and Charlie Angus, who are calling on Attorney General David Lametti to investigate crimes against Indigenous peoples carried out through the residential school system. There's a link to sign the petition that's being dropped in the chat right now.
Thank you, David. Hot Pot Talks is a weekly series live streaming to YouTube and Facebook every Wednesday at 5 p.m. Pacific time, where we have free-flowing conversations with artists, activists, chefs, performers, poets, community members, and organizers about what it means to be an artist facing today's realities. What ethical responsibilities do we have as artists? This season, we continue these conversations on topics ranging from anti-Asian racism, BIPOC futurity, Chinatown solidarity, diasporic food cultures, and interrogating the boundaries between everyday activism, fine art, and cultural work. We founded Love Intersections on the philosophy of collaboration, invitation, and relationship building with and within communities to tell intergenerational and intersectional stories. And a core part of our work as social practice artists has been to interrogate the boundaries of art, philosophy, community work, and activism. And when the pandemic put a pause on our creative and community work, we created Hot Pot Talks as a joyous way to continue this dialogue on art and cultural production with people we are inspired by.
Before we begin, I just want to thank our incredible team, Cameron, our project lead coordinator, and Lamia, our social media coordinator, who make Hot Pot Talks a reality. Now, without further ado, we are thrilled to invite Adrian Stimson to the Hot Pot table. Adrian Stimson is a member of the Siksika Blackfoot Nation in southern Alberta, Canada. He considers himself an interdisciplinary artist and exhibits nationally and internationally, working in visual art, performance, installation, and video. In 2018, Adrian was awarded the Governor General Award in Visual and Media Arts, and he was awarded the Blackfoot Visual Arts Award in 2009, the Queen Elizabeth II Golden Jubilee Medal in 2003, the Alberta Centennial Medal in 2005, and the Reveal Indigenous Arts Award, Nyatchin Foundation in 2017.
Welcome, Adrian.
Welcome, Adrian.
Thank you. Nice to be with you, Jen and David. Thank you for inviting me.
Hi, Adrian. Yeah. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing good. I'm actually just sitting here in the studio and I heard this funny little noise. And we've had a bit of a mouse infestation, not like Australia, but definitely I heard this little sort of like chewing over here. I'm like, what's that? I'm doing good.
Why don't we start with a fun question that I like to ask our guests, which is, how would you describe yourself outside of your profession? And if you want to make it juicier, what is something people seem to misunderstand about you?
Well, I'm beginning to think I'm an introvert. And I think that's just because of, I'm sure it's because of the pandemic. Mm-hmm. But how would I describe myself? Outside of the artistic profession, I would say I think I'm a bit of a hermit who likes to hang out in nature and commune with the animals. I think I have a lot more fun communing with animals than I do humans sometimes. But that could be that pandemic too. So yeah, I think a lot has changed.
Yes.
Yeah, I follow your Instagram. I love all your gopher gopher pictures.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, they're amazing little creatures. I'm becoming quite fond of them. And actually, I'm quite sure there's a huge subterranean kingdom right underneath me.
So, oh my gosh.
I'm sure they're partying all the time.
Oh, yes, yes, absolutely. Absolutely, they're ravers. They seem like ravers to me.
They are. You should see them fight. Oh my gosh, it's so funny when you watch them fight. It's like, oh.
Now, will you be incorporating gophers into your future work is the question I have.
I will, actually. I'm just working, amazing. Finishing off a bunch of work right now for an exhibition that's going to be at Museum London, Ontario in October, opening October. And one of the installation aspects of it, I have a bronze gopher with a gas mask on.
Wow. Oh my God, amazing.
And he's standing in front of a 20-foot bee tower.
Wow.
So yeah, Adrian, the animals are having a huge impact.
Yeah.
Adrian, I'm curious about your process. Can you tell us a little, maybe we'll start off with that to get into the art. What can you tell us about your practice and what's your process look like?
My process is procrastination.
You know what? I call it productive procrastination because I'm also an introvert and I find that, you know, we take our time and we really need to just feel things and sit things, you know, and let it all kind of percolate. So
it's called being an artist. It's called being an artist too, right?
And I always find that moment you have that sort of sense that, oh my God, this is due tomorrow. I should get it done.
Yeah.
It's like, no, it's not that bad. Mm-hmm. But no, really, when I think about my process, I do actually quite a bit of research to start things off. And so I'll just immerse myself. And it can be everything from formal academic work or literature to just, you know, the YouTube or Instagram or something like that. So I just spend a lot of time just sort of absorbing. Mm-hmm. And then at some point it just comes all out. I'm so happy and to have a studio where I can just go in and sit and maybe put one dash of paint on something and look at it for an hour. Is this right? Is this wrong? And really, it's just that process of going back and forth and thinking about things. And, you know, if you have friends who can lay their eyes on it and give you their opinion and help you as you move along, that helps too. But really, it's just really a process of just research and then doing it and then sitting back and going back and forth. That's what I find anyway. And that works with all aspects of my work, from painting to performance to installation to sculpture. So.
Is there anything you can't do?
Oh, there's a lot I can't do.
Well, honestly, I mean, I've been a huge fan of your work for a really long time. And one of the main reasons is just because of the way that you cross all of these many disciplines too. How do you choose the form that you share a story or do a message? Is there a
my undergraduate, I majored in painting. So I always think that, you know, painting is my first love, and it's sort of the way I see art or look at art is through sort of the eyes of a painter. So really it's this process of looking. And so for me, painting will always be my first love. But then when I moved into my master's, that's when I started to broaden my sort of interests in various disciplines. And I moved into installation and performance. And then it was really sort of dawned on me that, really I try to find the best media to portray the message. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, sometimes it's a painting, sometimes it's a sculpture, and sometimes it has to be performance. Really it's just, you know, and sometimes it can be a combination of all of them. So it's really, I think in this day and age, I know for a lot of artists, it's almost a necessity to be interdisciplinary so that you can cross all boundaries and, you know, the economics of it nowadays. I haven't reached that point where I can just sit in my studio and paint and sell one painting that will keep me going for a year.
Right.
I'm not there yet. I sure hope so. Maybe the lottery might help.
Yeah. Well, Jen and I encountered this even worse because, I mean, video, who buys video art?
No one's going to buy our videos. But they will, but we've carved a niche, David. Don't sell ourselves short. People invite us to screen our films and then present and do workshops that are related to the film. So I would say we were doing an okay job.
That's true. But Adrian,
that's great.
What you were describing, though, really sort of, this is what Jen and I are also bumping up against. You know, we started mm-hmm. with video, but also recognizing that there are other forms that are a different medium that can just convey something differently. Like, Jen, I'm just thinking about like the documentary, the Yellow Peril that we did, a documentary, mm-hmm. but then we turned it into a four channel installation to sort of give it a little bit more of an immersive feel and sort of other things that we've been things that we've been thinking about. Yeah.
Oh, that's great. You know, the beauty of art mm-hmm. is that, you know, it can go in any direction, and it always depends on the flow and the influence and the context and so many things that sometimes I begin a project in one media.
Yes.
And then all of a sudden I just like, no, maybe something else. And then suddenly it'll move into that. So it's really one of the fun things we get to do as artists is sort mm-hmm. of play with a number of different media and which is wonderful.
Yeah, and one of the questions that we were nerding out on and what we wanted to ask you is because I was saying to David earlier how I was very tired of queer art. and that as queer artists ourselves, we often get led into a very narrow confine of what queer art should look like. And then it often intersects with our race. So people often want mm-hmm. us to make art that speaks to racialized experiences and like mm-hmm. on our race and our bodies. And then conversely with like our queerness as well, like how that works with our gender and sexuality. And mm-hmm. I sometimes mm-hmm. wonder if it's just a trapping that, you know, the limitations of any identity we, you know, is that. So mm-hmm. I'm not sure. I wanted to ask you what your thoughts are around how you mm-hmm. access different art forms, but also what limitations you experience in the mm-hmm. art world from people who have expectations on you or not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, it is interesting, you know, as a Blackfoot person, Indigenous mm-hmm. To Canada, you know, for the longest time, you know, there was this expectation that I create a particular type of work. You know, of course, you know, it was all sort of stereotyped into beadwork and leather work and all that sort of stuff that, you know, that was kind of sort of the area that I could be or should be in. Mm-hmm. But that, you know, that changed very quickly when I entered the Western Academy mm-hmm. into contemporary art. And you know, we can't help but create art from ourselves, from our identity. You know, it's who we are. So we can't help, that can't help but be a part of what we do. However, having said that, you know, it's interesting because you do get pigeonholed sometimes, and people like have these expectations. Oh, you know, because I'm a queer male artist, I'm going to paint dicks all the time. You know,
dicks and rainbows,
and unicorns,
and, you know, and unicorns.
And while I've done that, you know, and in Vancouver at the Sun Gallery many years ago, it was a phase I was. It was a phase I was going through. Mm-hmm. I just needed mm-hmm. to do it. But but no, you know, it's interesting because, you know, our experience is very diverse. And, you know, it's not only cultural, it's not only, you know, sexual, it's you know, who we, our friends in the world, where we go in the world, mm-hmm. what we do in the world. So our experience is very, very varied. And, you know, so our art should reflect that, you know.
Yeah.
And so I think that, you know, I'm creating a whole body of work right now and working on some abstracts that I think is going to surprise people. They're going to think, oh, this isn't Adrian.
Wow.
you know, what's going on here? What's he doing here now? You know, how come he's not doing, you know, maybe, you know, certain types of work anymore? But, you know, I still will. But, you know, at the same time, it's like I like the ability to change. I think change is important. And I think from the perspective of an artist, I like to challenge myself to think, well, how can I do this differently? Mm-hmm. How can I maybe I'll do something completely different and freak everybody out. You know, it's like, you know, it's, I think that yes, far too often we get pigeonholed, not only by our identities, but by, you know, our communities we're in and such. But at the same time, you know, we should always, as artists, challenge that back, you know, in the sense that, you know, that we are more than what we appear to be.
Well, it's also, I'm just thinking, you know, Jen, this is also how we put together Hot Pot Talks too, sort of tearing apart those distinctions those boundaries that say this is this type of art, this is this type of art, this is art, this is not art. I'm curious if you find that there's like does the queer art world and the contemporary art world, do those things kind of bump up against each other? Those types, do you experience that at all? I'm curious.
Oh, I think so. You know, I think also too, you know, you have various levels. You have, you know, commercial galleries, you have, you know, exhibition galleries. And then, you know, you sort of determine to sort of create a certain body of work that fits those different places and stuff. Right. But I, you know, I think we do bump up against it a lot, you know, the sort of interplay between institutions and expectations too, sometimes within those institutions. But I also think too, you know, it's really often they're curated. So, you know, you really have to look to the curator to see what kind of direction they're going into too. So yeah, I think, yeah, it's sometimes it's complicated. Sometimes it's really simple, but I think the more you do your work and the more you're recognized for it, then your voice becomes sort of the leading sort of the guiding principles and what occurs within institutions. And, you know, depending on what you're working on, you know, you can present it. And, you know, there are some galleries that are not interested and others that are. So, I think it's a process. It's a process of coming to know what, you know, how to present your work and where to present it.
Right. Cool.
I'm super curious. I want to go back. I want to know if you can tell us where and how you grew up and what were you like as a kid? And if you had like a definitive kind of story or a moment when you were like, okay, I'm an artist or I want to be an artist when I grew up.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Do you have a few hours? I have a kind of a varied and very, it's, you know, it's a weird and sometimes sordid tale. You know, I was, my parents met in Ontario. My father was here from Siksika, my mom from Ontario. Met in Sault Ste. Marie at a residential school, conceived at a residential school. And then my family was interesting in the sense that my father ended up working in those schools and had traveled around to various schools. So as a result, I ended up going into those schools as a student, as a day student. And so I had that experience, which was not, you know, sometimes they're pretty horrible experiences. And in that time too, you know, I was in Saskatchewan. I guess I could say when I started to be more conscious about about my being and, you know, observing what was going on around me. And in Saskatchewan in particular, in the 70s, late 60s, early 70s, very racist. Yeah. You'd have these situations where as kids we'd go into town and, you know, we'd be attacked. So, you know, you think about things like that and how that sort of forms an individual's mind. Within, you know, within all that turmoil, there were moments of joy. And, you know, that was often, you know, I often found those, you know, traipsing through the woods or, you know, playing or going sliding or all those things. But in the summers, we would come out west to my grandparents' place. And my grandfather, the first Adrian Stimson, was a very, the Stimsons were actually really big, big fellas. They were like about 6'5", and, you know, they're very imposing. So I come from a very feared family in the sense that we're big, big people. And so my grandfather was a tall man, and he was coming back from the Indian hospital. He used to go over there for treatments because he suffered from, I think, scarlet fever as a kid. And he was a cowboy. He was an Indian cowboy in the Calgary Stampede. So he was like this sort of macho character. But he would come through the field. And I always remember in the summer when I was visiting, I'd watch him coming through the field, and it was just this big figure sort of coming at me. And it was my grandfather, and he was very loving towards me, of course. And he was actually, you know, I remembered this a few years ago, that he was actually the first person to teach me how to draw. And he actually sat down and he was drawing pictographs, Blackfoot pictographs, of a little, like a farmyard of a person or stuff like that. And then I started drawing. So I think that my love of art and my love came from my grandfather. But then also, too, on my mother's side, my grandmother was a very avid reader and artist herself. Mm-hmm. She was sort of like a hobbyist painter, watercolorist. Beautiful. I have one of her paintings. And she was always sort of directing me and sort of like talking about the arts, you know, when I'd visit her in the summer sometimes. And so really, this all came together, you know, in a way that art has always been in my life. And I've always sort of felt like I wanted to be an artist. But it took me a very long time to get there because, you know, I had many careers in the 80s. And then in the 90s, I was a native politician. And then at the end of that, I kind of asked myself that question, what do I want to be when I grow up?
Yeah. And
it's an artist. You know, I've always wanted to be an artist. So I really sort of decided to sort of see, well, if I really want to be it, can I do it? And so I put together a portfolio and drew my little heart out and submitted, and they accepted me.
And I
haven't looked back. So really, that was just, it's been a lifelong process. But I would say from a child to now that, you know, I've been very inquisitive. I think I'm inquisitive. I look a lot, you know, this is, I think artists, we tend to do, even as children, we observe,
we
watch everything around us. We're thinking about it. Like, people don't think we're thinking, but we're thinking about everything. It's like a little sort of a, I don't know what it would be, but it's just one of those situations that in the world we become these observers, these lookers. And in doing so, we observe every detail. And the details, not only in our environment, but details in personality, in people's beings, and all that sort of stuff. And we absorb this. So I really think that's sort of been a big part of my entire life, and really all our lives. And you know, and so I can really see that how becoming an artist was a natural process, even though it took a little while to get here.
Wow, that's so interesting. I'm actually just realizing I've never thought of it that way. Of just the inquisitive attention, not just attention to detail, but like all of the layers.
Well, David, yours and mine's is in the form of neuroses. Like, the attention to detail is sometimes.
Yeah,
You look fabulous. Love your hair. Thank you.
It's a part of the neuroses.
Well, he's a Leo, so
yes, and it's Leo season. So, Adrian, I want to ask you about Buffalo Boy. I love Buffalo Boy, and the Shaman Exterminator, right?
Yeah.
Amazing.
The Buffalo Boy's butt.
Oh, yeah, behind you. That's hilarious. can you tell us how you came up with that?
Yeah, absolutely. It was, I was during my master's at the University of Saskatchewan. It was on the coldest day of the year. Honestly, it was like minus 60. It was so cold in Saskatoon. You could hear like things cracking, like cars cracking. It was just the craziest day. And so I was in my studio, and I had been taking a class from Lynn Bell in performance art theory and praxis, and that was really introducing me into the history of performance art, and also Indigenous performance art. And so I was in my studio, and I was actually doing a lot of research around Buffalo Bill and his Wild West shows. Buffalo Bill being an American showman, used to be a buffalo hunter, Indian fighter. Had a lot of different sort of things, and he created the Wild West Show, Buffalo Bill's Wild West Show, and it was a spectacle, and it was, you know, it was including and excluding and creating these narratives about conquest of the Americas, and very colonial, very overtly manifest destiny, all that sort of stuff. And so I was really thinking about it, and then I was sort of thinking about my own being, and, you know, also at that time, sort of the pan-Indian sort of world that, you know, everybody thought, you know, the only Indians were Plains Indians, you know, that kind of thing. So, you know, and the appropriation of culture and stuff.
Yeah.
So I was sitting there and I was thinking, you know, Buffalo Bill, Buffalo Boy. And I thought that's where Buffalo Boy was, you know, it's like, oh boy, it's just, oh boy, oh boy. And I was just thinking about that. And that's where Buffalo Boy was born. And so then really started to sort of apply the performance art sort of history to it, and thinking about how Buffalo Boy is a bit of a spectacle, sort of modeled after Buffalo Bill, yet sort of looking, sort of taking the tenets of showmanship and sort of applying it against the colonial project, pan-Indianism, all those things. And so that's how sort of he came to be. So it really became sort of like a justice fighter in ways, sort of really attacking these systems, but in a sort of a comical way. So humor was always a part of the performance, but also, you know, hitting on very hard and heavy subject matter as well. And then from Buffalo Boy begat the Shaman Exterminator, which is a much more ominous figure with horns and the buffalo fur, and you don't really see, but it's really Buffalo Boy underneath that. And the Shaman Exterminator is really sort of looking at this sort of a more ominous, acts like a buffalo, sort of takes up space, is this more sort of, ominous character. And but then there was the third, who was born in Vancouver, during the performance festival that the one with it'll come to me anyway that one the Shaman Exterminator begat the Lord of the Plains, and the Lord of the Plains has only had a few performances, but is based on a moniker that was given to the Blackfoot, being called the Lords of the Plains. And so I decided to make a bit of a take on that. And so I created the Lord of the Plains. So an English dandy, very sort of up and very sort of loves to eat bonbons and pastries, and sort of the performance is usually end. And just stuffing his face to the point where his whole face is covered and all that sort of stuff, really speaking to excess. So those are my three sort of personas, and there is one more that has made only maybe one appearance, and that's Naked Nappy, but only one.
Yeah. Will we see any of these characters? Will they have new stories coming up anytime?
Buffalo Boy went to bed about two or three years ago, and my intent was sort of putting him to bed. But Buffalo Boy has this funny history. He's been killed. He's come back from the dead. He's been doing this. So he's a bit of a character, a bit of an enigma. Said that, you know, that he's gone to bed. But then Buffalo Boy was to make his last performance in Australia just as COVID hit. I was in Australia ready to perform with 30 some individuals who were going to be part of my performance, and COVID came down and we decided at the last minute to just cancel. So we canceled and I fled back to Canada. So Buffalo Boy was supposed to make an appearance of a revival then, but really hadn't. And it was Buffalo Boy's Last Stand with Tess. And it was a social justice issue with an Indigenous scholar, Tessa Lass, who was unceremoniously let go after 13 years from the University of New South Wales. And it was a travesty, and it was wrong, and it was racist, and it was misogynist, and it was sexist, and everything that institution did to that person was horrible. So Buffalo Boy, along with the Stand With Tess crew, which is a whole group of students from the University of New South Wales, who still carry the banner for Tess. So Buffalo Boy sort of came in and was going to do a last stand for Tess, and then that was canceled. But now we're doing a video. So I might come to you for some advice. So we've been working on this video for a year, and it's all a bunch of little performances in relation to Tess and the institution. And we're hoping at the end of this month that it's done, and then we're going to look at how we're going to show that. But that would be, there's a cameo of Buffalo Boy at 174 years old. Buffalo Boy has made it to 174 years old. So where is he now? Yeah. I don't know. So, right, so right. He might show up somewhere.
Right. Amazing.
So, you know, I've said he's been retired. I never say never, but it all depends on the context. And you know, Buffalo Boy demands like how many, 5 figures now or something?
Yes.
Yes. 100%. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah, he's very expensive now. So, you know, people better be able to afford them.
Oh, yeah.
That reminds me, for these types of performances, you know, one of my favorite questions to ask an artist, in your artistic practice is, do you work with a specific audience in mind when you're, you know, when you're coming up with and practicing these performances, like when you're choreographing these performances, do you work with an audience in mind?
I work for everybody. Well, definitely, you know, the work, you know, depending on the work itself, there's always, you know, an indigenous audience that has perhaps some inside or sort of experience. So they'll have a quicker reaction to it. But I really think I create my work for all audiences, you know, who's ever willing to take a look and who's ever willing to sort of delve into it. You know, it's interesting, you know, throughout my performance history and art history, you know, there are exhibitions that's all of a sudden our performances were only, let's say, 3 or 4 people show up and performances where 200 to 500 people show up. So, you know, it's just this really thing. And I've always told, you know, curators of those events, you know, if they're really, oh my God, I'm so sorry, only 3 people showed up. And I said, oh, don't worry about that. I'm here for those 3 people.
Yeah.
I'm here for those 200 and some people. You know, it doesn't matter the numbers. I've never worried about numbers. For me, it's that moment and that intimacy between yourself and your audience. And so for me, it's that privilege and that honor of being able to create my work and show my work to who's ever willing to watch comment, you know, and comment, because, you know, that's part of our world. Our art world is, you know, critique and understanding what we're doing, you know, as artists. You know, there's some things that I look back on and say, why did I ever do that? You know, that's all a learning process.
Absolutely. And on the topic of critique too, I'm curious if you, because what I find is like for David and myself, because we work with such, you know, specific, often with such specific audiences, with like queer Asians is kind of our biggest demographic. I hate that word, but, and I find that I'm sharper and my like senses have to be more refined, because I find that the most critiques come from within the community. And I'm curious if you experience more critiques from within from different Indigenous communities, and what your experience has been like with quote unquote critique. Controversies. Yeah.
Yeah. Critique is an interesting thing. You know, I haven't had, you know, fortunately or unfortunately, I haven't had too many controversies per se. You know, most of my work is controversial anyway. So it's like, it's going to push some buttons or you know, pull some triggers for sure. Critique, you know, I think one of the things that I've found, especially with the Indigenous art communities, we're very gentle with each other in how we approach critique. We don't directly sort of say, oh, that's shit. You know, maybe some people would, but, you know. But, you know, we engage in a conversation, and often we find context, and like anything, any person who's coming to an artwork should do is, you know, find out about it before they really make a judgment on it. So I think that in the Indigenous art world, for the longest time, there was sort of a gentleness in there. That's shifting. We're reaching a critical mass where we're hitting all of a sudden explosion of artists, which is fantastic. Yeah. Is that now, you know, there's a lot of intersections happening. And one of the things that, you know, as older artists, and we notice of younger artists, is sometimes they're not acknowledging or seeing what's come before them and thinking that they've come up with it. So there's that, you know, so there's little things like that we have to be sort of aware of. And yet at the same time, there are things that emerging artists are doing that are fantastic. You know, it's like, oh my God, they're really pushing the envelope. You know, it's like, whoa. You know, it's for an artist that has been considered to push the envelope, I haven't pushed the envelope nearly as much as some of these younger people do.
Yeah, so, part you know, of- Go ahead.
Oh, yeah. So it's just, you know, so it's that process. But, you know, it's also interesting to critique in generally. I think there's also this sometimes this reticence for non-Indigenous people to critique my work, or fear that something's going to, you know, they're going to say something wrong or something like that. And, you know, I'm pretty gentle. So I, you know, I help people if they're sort of not understanding the terms and stuff like that. But, you know, but generally, I think those people who perhaps have issues with my work or stuff, stay away from me. they don't critique me. So that's fine. I could, because, you know, it depends on their critique, you know, because I'm pretty fierce in how I respond sometimes. you know, which we have to do as artists, because, you know, there's this thing that, you know, we're creating these works and we're putting it out there in the world and they're part of us. So of course we're going to take things, you know, sometimes personally, but we learn how not to do that as artists. We learn how to separate ourselves a bit to be able to understand critique and not react to it in an emotional way, even though sometimes inside it's like, what the fuck are they talking about? So it's like, so it's a sort of sense of sort of allowing that. The other thing is academic, you know, critique is interesting, because, you know, that, you know, sometimes when I read an academic, for even though I am an academic in many ways, even though I haven't really sort of gone further to get a doctorate or anything, but I sometimes have, like, sit there and reread things over and over again, because the words that are being used are new words, which I love. You know, I have to say, I'm not anti-intellectual. I think it's fantastic that it's actually challenging my mind to learn and understand. And often I find that that furthers knowledge and is interesting too. It can be intimidating sometimes, because, you know, I can't say half the words, but but, you know, but I'm getting there. And I think one of the things, the beautiful things as an artist, and as you mature as an artist, is that you become more confident in what you're doing, you know, and also willing to take risks. You know, that's the other aspect of it. You never stop taking risks, because, you know, that really furthers knowledge. It challenges your own mind to think, you know, differently. And so I think, you know, that's, you know, the world of critique for me. And I hope it always shifts. And, you know, I have to say that, you know, we're things are shifting so fast. That, you know, and especially with COVID, I was thinking today that, you know, everything in the next year to 2 years is going to be different. Our art world is going to be different. The contacts a lot of us made earlier are maybe sort of drifted apart. You know, we're forging new relationships. Old relationships has gone to the side. It's really sort of bizarre, and I'm still wrapping my mind around it, but at the same time navigating it while it's happening. as we all are.
Yes.
Yeah. What you're saying reminds me, I mean, Jen and I went through this a couple years ago, where a piece that we made provoked a certain reaction. And this was one of the very first times we had exhibited work like this before. And I just remember Jen and I realizing a couple days later, actually, that was the point of what we were trying to do, is actually, you know, have this type of conversation and provoke it through a piece of art. So it was an interesting also way of, like, okay, the emotional part, put it aside and actually, this is the work of the artist.
But it's also interesting too, interesting too, because it's part of creating the work is defending the work. You know, and that's interesting too, because, you know, that's that whole sort of, because sometimes people look at their work and misunderstand it. So you have to be able to tell them, you know, that no, the way you're looking at it is not is not a way to look at it. You know, it's maybe your way to look at it, but of course, I'm not saying tell them not to look at it that way. But I'm just saying that this is the context. This is what, you know, when it was made, why it's been made and stuff. I think, you know, defense is also important as well, because people sometimes will take you to task for no reason, just for the sake of taking you to task. And so I think you also have to be able to sort of fight back. So,
Sorry, Adrian, I really wanted to ask you about your piece at the Remy. The Inisukumapi, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. One of the reasons why I was inspired to invite you to Hot Pot Talks was because I saw the talk you did with Tara Hoag, where you talked about this piece. It features, I believe, a piece of work that you did alongside a collaboration with A.A. Bronson. One of Bronson's ancestors was a missionary in the residential school that you and your ancestors attended. Is that correct?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and I'm curious if you could tell us about how that collaboration unfolded, and I'm also particularly interested with the dinner piece too, because you know, for the obvious reasons of hot pot talks and sharing a meal. Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely. No, I think it's wonderful. Thank you for asking me that question. It's an interesting story. It's just another sort of weird thing when the stars align and these weird sort of happenstance. And, you know, how did this come to be? And I still sometimes get a little sort of starstruck, or not starstruck, star wonder about how it all came together. Anyway, so the truth is, the truth of history is that A.A. Bronson's great-great-grandfather was the Reverend Timms. And the Reverend Timms was the first Anglican missionary to the Blackfoot Reserve. And he was responsible or helped create the first Blackfoot mission, the church, the homestead, and the residential school. According to our history and AA's history, is that he was a very pious man, a very strict man, so much so that he created a lot of enemies of the Blackfoot, and in particular, to a point where he was keeping the children in the school dying and not letting them go home to their parents to die. So, of course, you know, the outrage of that from the parents led to him being threatened, and eventually he fled, and the school and the mission and everything was burnt to the ground. It was a bit of a rebellion. So AA, you know, not to tell an AA story, has, you know, been aware of this history because it caused trauma in his own family, as he recounts. And that history. So he's always been sort of aware of this dubious history of his relation, and he wanted to do something about it. And so he reached out to curator Candace Hopkins and asked if she knew any Blackfoot artists, particularly from Siksika, who he could make contact with and start having a discussion. Lo and behold, I know Candace. And so she said, well, why don't you talk to Adrian? And so, as it turns out, weirdly enough, like Olson was my great-great-grandfather, who was an archenemy of the Reverend Timms, but they were sort of frenemies in the sense that they were enemies, but they were friends in a weird way. And so really, both our grandparents are directly related in this situation. And so he wanted to make a public apology to Siksika. And so he asked me to, you know, about that and what I thought about it. So I decided to help facilitate it and help him work through this process. So I approached elders, I approached our chief and council, saying, looking, this fellow, a fellow artist, his grandfather was the Reverend Tim, wants to make a public apology to us for his family's history. Should we listen? You know, should we accept this? And, you know, and AA has approached it in a good way, is that he came to us and asked us if he could make an apology first. You know, if it was an appropriate thing to do. And so talking to elders, one of the elders said to me, Myrna said to me, she said, you know, not too often do we get people coming to apologize to us, individuals coming to apologize to us as a nation. So let's listen to him. And so one of the first opportunities was for AA to come to Siksika for the very first time in his life. And so I invited him down to my home here at Siksika, invited some elders to the table. And so I decided to call it Buffalo Boys, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. Ini Sakkomapi is the Blackfoot term, which I changed it for the installation. But I changed into Buffalo Boy and hosted the dinner. And it was really this sense, if you're familiar with movies of the 60s, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner with Sidney Poitier. And that historical movie, which of course was about race relations and race history. And so I, you know, in a sort of Buffalo Boy kind of way, trickster kind of way, sort of thought this was a good title for us to meet. But the importance of that dinner can't be underscored, in the sense that it was an opportunity for us to all sit down and have a discussion, because AA had come here to do some more research at the Glenbow Museum and stuff like that, to talk about what an apology means, what it is and stuff. So we had a really around the dinner table, which I think is the most important place to have these kind of conversations. And talk in an open and safe way. And so, yeah, so we had those conversations. It was a beautiful evening of sharing, of tears. It was also very heavy too, because, you know, as you well know, the history of residential schools in this country is a shameful one. But for Indigenous people, a very difficult one to talk about in many different ways. Yet it's important to talk about, because if we don't talk about it, we can't exercise that historical damage and such. So that meeting, you know, there was a moment when AA, you know, sort of, you know, said out loud that this is genocide. And we had, you know, we really talked about that in so many ways. So it was a good, opportunity. And so for me, AA had asked me to respond. It's more of a response than a collaboration. And to his research, to his sort of finding, and he actually did find quite a bit of research. And interestingly enough, when I informed our chief and counsel at the time about some of that research, our land claims department sort of it raised their eyebrows saying, oh, some of this information may help us. So in essence, what AA is doing, the research he has done and stuff like that, could also help us in relation to legal issues and stuff like that. So, you know, so there are many levels of this. So then when I thought about the response, I thought, okay, it's in the gallery setting. What am I going to do? So I thought, well, so I decided to create a table and filled, and I got actually a friend of mine, Gordon Littlelight. He's a former Old Sun Residential School survivor, agreed to make a table similar to the tables that were at the residential school. So he did the table, and then I appointed it with fine dining ware, quite opposite to what would have been in the schools. And then put 10 bison, bronze bison, because I work with bison, and bison are analogous so much to the history of Indigenous people, the slaughter, the getting them rid of them for the land. And then above it was actual a light from Old Sun Residential School. So that sort of illuminates the whole piece. But in doing that, you know, it also to the aspect of 10, for me, I've used 10 a lot in my work because it relates to that childhood song, 10 Little Indians, the systemic getting rid of each Indian, each verse. If you look at that childhood gun, you want to understand the in-depth nature of, you know, Canadians and Americans hating Indigenous people. Look at the children's songs that were produced, you know, it's like that's where it started. So for me, that's a common theme. And then behind it, I put a drawing of the girls in the canteen. So it kind of all goes together. So for me, creating that table was a response to that history. But I wanted to sort of, in terms of the entirety of the installation, there are other elements of school kid or school boys from Old Sun, three sculptural elements of pictographs of short robes, which was the first Anglican missionary, the Reverend Timms. I made one of Old Sun. And then there was another one of Old Sun Burning. So all together, this installation really sort of looked at this sort of very serendipitous history that, you know, how, you know, like you think about these weird things of how, again, how these things happen is that both our grandfathers, the history of residential schools, were both artists, were both queer. I'm two-spirited queer, you know, all those things. So all these things have led to this interesting sort of moment in time where AA and I are still working through these issues. Last year we were hoping to sort of do one more aspect, and that was AA coming back. He performed the apology at the Toronto Biennial with Blackfoot elders there and myself, and we receiving it and taking it back to Siksika. But there was always the element of him coming back to Siksika and joining us. So that process we still hope to undertake, and that is for me to sponsor a round dance where I'd invite him. He delivered the apology to the people, and we would have a round dance together, a celebration and a feast. And for that, really, that would really sort of end the protocol aspects of the apology. What's occurring now is what I think is important for all Canadians to understand is that relationships are between people. And we have to start building those relationships in a way that's good. And so I think that my friendship with AA is ongoing. We talk quite regularly on little art things, you know, and stuff. So really that's speaking to the tenets of building relationships. And so for me, that's sort of an ongoing process. And, you know, you have to wonder, you know, why have we been brought together? Why are we creating this work? My hope in all of this is that it raises awareness. it attacks those issues of discrimination and racism, and really looks to build a more understanding and a world I'm sure we all really want.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it's just why I love the metaphor of the dinner too, right? Yeah. I mean, you guys actually have the dinner, but it's also thinking about it as a metaphor for those types of relationship building. What sort of changes when you have to, when you break bread with someone, right? That it all of a sudden the energy shifts as well. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it is. And that's understanding, you know, and it's sad in our time, you know, when you see the strife that's going on and the resurgence of the racism and the incidents and stuff like that. It just, you know, and that whole thing that's happening south of us, it's just, it's happening here too. But, you know, it's just like people become so ideologically bound that they can't seem to see any other points of view. And that's sad, because if people continue in that vein, where are we going to end up? It's just going to be nothing but fighting. And, you know, I'm getting to a point in my life that I'm a little tired of fighting. You know, I want to, you know, I still have a lot of fight in me, but I want to watch the gophers. I want to watch the birds. I want to sit back. I want to enjoy the beauty of life, the beauty of humanity. That's what I want. Yeah. I want to see more of that. And, you know, all that stuff it will exist, and we'll keep dealing with that.
Wise words, such wise words. You're really speaking to the heart of Love Intersections, which is, you know, it's all about relationship building, and through the true in good faith kind of collaborations that we have with people, and like face to face. And I think we've lost some of that because so much of our organizing and activism has to take place online, and now you said that so wisely in terms of we don't even know what the world is going to look like in a post-pandemic world. I think we're going to experience some we're already being gaslit, so as a whole. But, you know, I have concerns, but at the same time I'm also really inspired by the kind of visibility that BIPOC content creators have online. So I struggle with those tensions, I think. Because on one hand, I really want to be offline and just be in the world and be present in the world and be in nature. I also, you know, prefer animals to humans. but at the same time, I still have to contend with the virtual and contend with different ways of interaction. It's an interesting place to be.
Exactly. Oh, don't get me wrong. I love going to a big city. Actually, it's really good for this country boy who lives in the middle of nowhere to get out to the city every now and then. No, really.
It's true.
I need something to influence my art a bit more.
That's hilarious.
And I need to get to Vancouver soon. I'm missing Vancouver.
Yes.
Yes.
We will take you out for a hot pot if you're ever here.
I was actually thinking in the 90s, almost every summer, for about a month or 2 weeks, I'd get to Vancouver. And actually, probably at this very point, I'd be climbing those stairs off Rhett Beach.
Well, Adrian, we're running close to the end of our time, but I wanted to ask you what, because you set up that a hot pot behind you for today. I'm curious, what is your favorite hot pot ingredient or experience?
I have to admit, I bought this hot pot and the heating part for it after a most lovely dinner with fellow artists Ed Peen and Johanna Zitz in Toronto a number of years ago. And oh my gosh, the spread they put out was the thin pork, the mushrooms, the broth, the seafood broth, the beef broth. All the different vegetables. It was just like, it was just amazing. And so I was just so inspired by it, and it was absolutely delicious. I love all of it. And and so I was like, oh, all gung ho. I came back home to my husband and I'm like, we're going to go out and get a hot pot. We're going to get this. We're going to have one of these nights. And then it didn't happen. So I am still fully intending to. And I love the veggies. I have to say the mushrooms for sure. The little broccolis or something. I can't remember their names and stuff like that. So anyway, it is there, and I thought I'd bring it up, especially for you folks, because
tonight's vlog,
and I make a promise that I am going to get at it.
Amazing.
Well, this is your opportunity. If you want to plug your future plans, what are you working on now? Is there anything you want to plug away? This is really a chance for you to shout out.
Great. No, thank you. No, I'm just in, as I mentioned earlier, I'm just in the process of finishing up a bunch of work for the Gardenship project through the University of Western Ontario, which will be shown at Museum London, Ontario in October. That was delayed a year. And so for that, I'm creating a big 20-foot bee tower. I have three abstract paintings, the gopher, a bee outfit that's has 300 Amazing. Beaded bees on it. And stuff. Wow. So that's happening in October. I'm actually still waiting for the announcement to the National Monument to Canada's mission in Afghanistan. It was supposed to be announced now, but we got notice that they're going to wait until the fall. Waiting sort of on, enthusiastically for that, hoping that we get it, because that will sort of keep us very busy for the next few years. Mm-hmm. I'm actually going to Wanuskewin for a residency in September for 2 weeks. So I'm going to be hanging out at Wanuskewin in the Remy Art Gallery and hanging there with their new buffalo herd. So very excited about that, because really, what other residency can I go to that I just hang out with a buffalo herd? So,
oh my God, amazing.
So that's happening. And other than that, other little things are starting to come to light, slow but sure. One of the things that happens is, as an artist, as you evolve, is the possibility of public projects. So I'm, in competition for a few of those projects right now and finishing off. Actually, Northern Lights Military Cemetery in Edmonton. I got three large aluminum panels going in that cemetery in the next while on the theme of peace. So there are a number of things happening. But for me, I think I'm just enjoying the summer, even though we have a bit of that smoke coming into us. But, just enjoying the summer, enjoying the garden. Just really stopping and, as they say, smelling the crocuses. smelling the crocus and watching the gophers. For me right now, that's giving me the greatest joy. And so that's what's happening for me right now.
Amazing.
Thank you so much, Adrian.
Thank you so much, Adrian, for joining us today. It's been a pleasure having you.
Oh, thank you. It's a pleasure to be with you too today. And I hope that in the near future, I can get out that way and we can actually sit down and see each other in person and have a good laugh.
Can't wait.
Thank you.
Don't go anywhere. Okay. Oh my gosh. Okay. I could listen to Adrian talk forever. What incredible stories. We should have allotted for 3 hours. I do just want to showcase this comment because it was really lovely from a comment from Glenn.
Oh.
Yeah. So nice.
That's very kind.
So who is our next guest? Is it Savoy?
Yes. Next week, we are going to talk to Savoy Williams, a friend of ours, who is, a personal trainer, but has a focus on trying to create a more inclusive fitness industry. So that'll be another very interesting conversation.
And as someone who has no fitness, athletic kind of skill set, I'm very curious to ask him questions. All right. Thank you, everyone. See you next Wednesday.
Join you next week. Bye.